food bank. Thank you. From the monthly newsletter, you will see that we're holding the APCM on the 25th of October, Sunday, at 12 noon in church, immediately following the usual of the Matins Bible Sunday. So please do come if you can. A reminder again about COVID restrictions today. Apart from queuing up the door and sanitizing your hands or wearing masks, we follow a one-way system. So you go out through the cute channel, and at the moment we can't see. You can sing the hymns by that if you wish. We'll be having a CD on sing them. Or you can hold on, don't tell a couple of us. Please leave your hymn books and prayer in the pews. We'll collect them up afterwards. Keep warm. Hopefully you might have a chill of air. Food must be close to the door of my wife. So you're very welcome to bring blankets, hot water bottles, caps, anything you want, some underwear included. But as winter draws on, it's going to get very cold. But it doesn't. No, I haven't forgotten something. It's all this. My guardian angel, Sandra, wants me to remind you that on the first Sunday in November, I think that's on the first, and the first Sunday in November is All Souls Day, and we'll be having a special service in the afternoon at 4 o'clock. Oh no, 3 o'clock. Well, 3 o'clock. And that's a quiet service of remembering our loved ones, departed loved ones, with Thanksgiving. There's a list at the back for names. Please put the names of our loved ones down there. We'll be reading them out, and we'll this time be lighting candles for you. Loved ones' names, if we're not stand up, and then we've got the plan. I think that's just about all. As you say, the theme of today's service is about harvest, the harvest of the vineyard. I have to sit with David's next door. Our hymns, psalm, anthem, and readings are all about vineyards, as is unfortunately my sermon. I now publish. Marriage between David James Arnold of St John Baptist Hill Morton and Rina Ann Varkey of St Mary's South Wycliffe. This is the first time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these two may not marry each other, you are to be told. Pray for David and Rina, and indeed for all of our wedding couples. Lord, the source of all true love, we pray for this couple and all our wedding couples. Grant to them joy of heart, seriousness of mind, and reverence of spirit, that as they enter into the oneness of marriage, they may be strengthened and guided by you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now I invite you to stand and listen or say or hum our first hymn, which is apposite enough, We Plough the Fields and Stand, number 290.
Thank you.
Those things may please him which which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips. O God, make speed to save us.
We'll
stand up and exercise our legs. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name.
Remain standing to say the first 10 verses of the 19th of the page. We'll say it all together. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, he made it, and his hand prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And now we're going to say together, I thought that having this sung on the CD was quite a long psalm, and it's quicker to read. So we're going to read it. We're going to read it alternately. It's going to be Psalm 80. You'll find that at the back of your PCP on page 521. Psalm 80. Page 521, I'm going to read the odd verses and you will read the even verses. Hear, O thou shepherd of Israel, thou that leadest Joseph like a sheep, show thyself also that thou sittest upon the cherubims. Turn us again, O God. Show the light of thy countenance, and we shall be whole.
The Lord God of hosts, how long thou find them and thy people in bread?
Thou feedest them with the bread of tears, and givest them plenteousness of tears to drink.
Thou hast made us a strife unto our enemies, and thy enemies are us sore.
Turn us again now, Lord of hosts. Show the light of thy countenance, and we shall be whole.
Thou hast brought the vine out of Egypt, thou hast cast out the kingdom and out of it.
Thou madest room for it, and when it had taken root, it filled the land.
The hills were covered with the shadow of it, and the boughs thereof were like good cedar trees.
She stretched out her branches unto the sea, and her boughs unto the river.
Why hast thou thy river down thy mountain? For the whole day of thereby up before the lakes.
The wild boar out of the wood doth root it up, and the wild beasts of the field doth devour it.
What heard ye again of thy God of hosts? Look down from heaven, behold, and visit the sky.
And the place of the vineyard that thy right hand hath planted, and the branch that thou made so strong. Let thy hand be upon the man of thy right hand, and upon the son of man, whom thou madest so strong for thy own son.
And so will not be heard back from me. But let us live, and we shall call upon thy name.
Turn us again, O Lord God of hosts. Show the light of thy countenance, and we shall be whole. Say here the doctor. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now,
judgment, but behold oppression. For righteousness, but behold crime. Here endeth the first lesson.
Stand to say the first 13 verses of the Te Deum, week 5. I think we'll say it all together, not antiphonally. We praise thee, O God, we acknowledge thee to be the Lord. All the earth has worshipped thee, Father everlasting. To thee all angels cry aloud, the heavens and all the powers therein. To thee the cherubim and the seraphim continually to cry. Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth, heaven and earth are full of the majesty of thy glory. The glorious company of the apostles, praise thee. The goodly fellowship of the prophets, praise thee. The noble army of martyrs, praise thee. The holy church throughout all the world doth acknowledge thee, the Father of an infinite majesty, thy Apostles' Creed will confirm our belief. No, we don't. We get it. We never say that you will not. Which I put in front of my running one. If you'd like to stand, exercise your legs, we're going to say the Jubilate on page 6. O be joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Be sure that the Lord, he is God. He has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. O go your way to his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and speak good of his name. For the Lord is gracious, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth from generation to generation. Glory be to God, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And now, remaining standing, we can indeed recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and to forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us.
Grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the queen.
And mercy hear us as we call upon thee.
Endue thy ministers with righteousness.
And make thy chosen people joyful.
O Lord, save thy people.
And bless thy inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord.
For there is none other that flies before us, but let me now, O God.
O Lord, make clean our hearts within us.
And take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
I'm going to say an extra collect. First of all, there's a collect for harvest thanksgiving. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, thou crownest the year with thy goodness, and thou givest us the fruits of the earth in their season. We beseech thee that we might use them to thy glory, for the relief of those in need, and for our own well-being. We ask this through our Saviour, Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost, one world, one God, world without end.
Amen.
A special collect, this is for those preparing for ordination. I'm taking this from the BCP form and manner for the ordering of priests. This is not what Caroline and Jane will be hearing, but I like the wording. So let us pray. Almighty God, giver of all good things, who by thy Holy Spirit hast appointed divers orders of ministers in thy church, mercifully behold thy servants, Caroline Lathenby and James Scoville, now called to the office truth of thy doctrine, and adorn them with the innocency of life, that both by word and good example they may faithfully serve thee in this office, to the glory of thy name, and the edification of thy church. The merits of our Saviour Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, world without end. Second Colic for peace. God, who art the author of peace and the lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defence, may not fear the power of any adversaries, the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stay together. Third Collect for Grace. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings may be ordered by thy governance, to do always that is righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we now, as it says in the book, in choirs and places where they sing, here follows the anthem. Well, the anthem today is the motet for the time of Lent, set by François Poulenc, who's a French composer of the mid-20th century. Written this piece in 1938, text is Inea Mea Electa. It's the third response from our Matins on Good Friday on the Divine Office. An English translation goes, theme, once again about office. O vineyard, my chosen one, I planted you. How are you changed from sweet to bitter, to crucify me and released Barabbas? I protected you. I have removed stones that could bother you and built a tower for your defense. So now Robin will play us this motet. It is quite astringent. It is quite loud, but it gets quite loud halfway through. But the text serves it. I'm sure you will like it.
Thank you.
see it in the scriptures. Christ basically saying, how on earth can you have sent Barnabas away in peace and crucified me? So now I come to my stone, which I can't find. It is in this pile somewhere. Here it is. It's not getting away, but I'm not sure. It's a dark, big yard, by the way. May I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And last weekend, my wife and I took an early morning stroll through the David's vineyard. After meeting stray dog walkers, the old bicyclist, and a surprising number of early morning runners, we had the place more or less to ourselves. The weather was cold, but the sunshine was brilliant. A truly autumnal day. We noticed that most, but I remember all, of the vines had already been harvested. Walking through the vineyard reminded me of our last service a couple of weeks ago, Choral Evensong, when we looked at Matthew's account of the parable of the workers in the vineyard. Those of you who were there will hopefully remember the story of the workers in the vineyard who were recruited at progressively later times in the working day to gather and harvest the vineyard. Workers, no matter how long they actually worked, or during the day, all paid the same penny. The going rate for some days work. Look at the moral of that story. Well, let's meet. Today's readings are all about vines and vineyards again. Perhaps it's because of that time of the year, autumn, harvest. And after today's service is actually bills of Matins. At any rate, today's Old Testament reading from chapter 5 of Isaiah is a sort of parable about God planting a vineyard. He toiled over it, fenced it to protect it from wild beasts, or digging it from the stones, planting choice vines, and building a tower in the midst of it, not quite what the tower was for. Look out to prevent people licking the grapes. And they're building a wine press for it. But what happened? The vines produced wild grapes, little grapes, sour, bitter grapes. No good for pressing, but turning to wine, really vinegar, bitter, sour. What had gone wrong? What more could God have done? And what does God do? He takes away the hedge, the fence, opening the vines up to be trodden down and eaten up by wild animals. God lays the vineyard to waste. It is not to be tended, nor dug, nor pruned. Briars and thistles grow instead, and drought kills off what is left. The reading ends with the brief explanation of the parable. The vineyard of the Lord is, in reality, the nation of Israel, which has erred and strayed and followed false gods. The land is to be laid waste, ravaged by foreign oppressors from Assyria and Babylon. A sorry cautionary tale indeed. And then we come to the psalm. He said psalm 80 together, and basically more about vines and vineyards. Here's a quote from it. Thou hast brought a vine out of Egypt. It's a reference to Exodus. Thou hast cast out a planted Israel. Thou hast made us room for it, and when it had taken root, filled the land. She, the land, stretched forth her branches into the sea, as the Mediterranean, and her bounds the river, as the Mesopotamia. So it's expanding the empire, the Israelite empire, the time of David and Solomon. The psalmist goes on, the psalmist says, why hast thou then broken down her hedge, that all they that go by pluck off the grapes, the wild boar out of the woods, hath rooted up the wild beast that hath devoured it? Turn thee again, O God of hosts, look down from heaven, and visit this vine, visit Israel. Come back. I'm not sure which text that's Israel had not fulfilled the promise. Stray from the ways of Mount Carmel, to the Torah, the law given to them by God on Mount Sinai. Moses, the law, came the prophets, especially Isaiah, who warned the people of Israel of the errors of their ways, but to no effect. Either foreign aggressors, aggressive empires of Assyria and Babylon, which surrounded the tiny land of Israel, came and devoured it all. The northern kingdom of Israel fell to the Assyrians in the 8th century, and the southern kingdom of Judah to the Babylonians in the 6th century. The rest is, as they say, Israel. Before we come to today's second reading, I'd like to say a few words about that anthem we heard reading before the sermon. It was very beautiful, but sometimes overpowering setting. A Latin text by the mid-20th century composer Poulenc. I just repeat those words of the text. O vineyard, my chosen one, I planted you. How are you changed from sweet to bitter? To crucify me and release perhaps? It's about vineyards again. Latin text is said or sung as a responsory during Matins on Good Friday, and while it clearly draws the biblical passage we've just been discussing, it also focuses on Jesus as divine, about which we read in chapter 15 of John's Gospel. It's a bit different. I am the true vine, says Jesus, and my Father is the husband. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. Every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. In this passage, Jesus is identifying himself with God, the planter of the vineyard. But then he goes on to remonstrate with the vineyard. The people of Israel, why is their fruit, the grapes, why have they now turned from being sweet? Compares this to the text, being crucified, as the robber and murderer of Barabbas is released. Which brings us to today's second reading, which was from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21. Yet another parable, this time the parable of the wicked tenants in the vineyard. Now, for once, we have a parable which seems to be pretty self-explanatory. Jesus is telling this parable to against the chief priests and elders, like the local dignitaries. The storyline is quite simple. A certain householder, if we have to cover, plants a vineyard, Israel, hedges it around, gets a wine press, builds a tower. We've heard the story a number of times now, so far so good. But the imagery now is slightly different. The householder, the owner of the vineyard, lets out the vineyard to some husbandmen, clearly meant to refer to the chief priests and elders. The scum was off to a far country. When harvest time comes, the owner, God, sends his servant to collect the fruits of the harvest, the profits. But these husbandmen, to whom the vineyard had been let, tenants are wicked. It's the name of this parable. Wicked tenants. They beat, stone, and kill the servants sent by the owner to collect his dues. Finally, the owner sends his only son, which we are to understand Jesus, thinking, perhaps naively, that these wicked tenants will somehow respect his son. As before, the rest is, as they say, history. Wicked tenants kill the son, I crucify Jesus Christ, thinking that they will somehow obtain his inheritance. Jesus, thus proleptically speaking in advance, refers to his own crucifixion in this parable. Clearly, all this has to end in tears. As the text tells us, the vineyard owner, God, will miserably destroy those wicked tenants, will in instead let out his vineyard to other husbandmen, shall render them the fruits of the vineyard in their seasons. This is possibly a reference to the teaching of Christianity to other nations, or even the ethnoi, the Gentiles. The parable then ends with the chief priests and elders recognizing that Jesus means to categorize them as wicked husbandmen. However, they are, at least for the time being, powerless to lay hands on him in public, since the people, for the time being, took Jesus' prophet, i.e., the authorities were prevented by public opinion from arresting him in broad daylight. Alternative arrangements would have to be found, and as we know, they were. The moral of the story is that Isaiah, the psalmist, and Jesus all sought to explain that our tenure here on earth is conditional. Bluntly, we have to play by the rules, either the rule of the Torah given to Moses on Mount Sinai, or by the re-exposition of those rules set down by Jesus in his teachings, as for example in the Sermon on the Mount. None of us have a guaranteed right to own the produce. Don't have an automatic right to salvation or of entry into the kingdom of heaven. We must carefully and responsibly tend the vineyard. This is what I take that from. Tend the vineyard which has been let to us as stewards, not owners. It is not ours to exploit for our benefit. Remember the saying of Jesus, which I quoted at the end of my last. The harvest truly is plenteous. Laborers are few. Amen. And now it is time to say our prayers. So if I have to remain seated,
Thank you.
Son Jesus Christ is the first fruits of the resurrection and will reap the harvest of the dead at the end of time. We pray that he will gather us all together with those who have gone before in the banquet of the age to come. Especially remember and pray for the souls of the faithful departed.
Thank you.
understand. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
peace of God.